us to the rest of the news. Today marks the 68th anniversary of the bombing of Hiroshima. On August 6, 1945, an atomic bomb was dropped on that city of 350,000 people, killing up to 140,000 people. 3 days later, an additional nuclear bomb was dropped on the city of Nagasaki, killing tens of thousands more. Earlier today, 50,000 people stood for a minute of silence in Hiroshima's Peace Park near the epicenter of the blast. And while the people of Japan are marking the anniversaries of these catastrophic events, they're having to deal with another nuclear crisis at the same time, Fukushima. Yesterday, a spokesperson with Japan's Nuclear Regulatory Authority told reporters that highly radioactive water spilling into the oceans surrounding the stricken Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant is creating an emergency, their word, emergency, that plant officials are struggling to control. The spokesperson said that TEPCO, the operator of the crippled Fukushima plant, has no real plan to deal with the radioactive water leaks, and that the company's, quote, sense of crisis is weak, end quote. Joining me now to talk more about the situation in Fukushima is Kevin Camps, radioactive waste watchdog with Beyond Nuclear. Kevin, welcome back.
Thank you, Tom.
Great to have you with us. Do you agree with Japan's Nuclear Regulatory Agency that there's an emergency right now at Fukushima?
Well, the news is really bad. There seems to be an underground flood of radioactively contaminated water that's defying any constraints that Tokyo Electric is trying to put in place. And the head of the Nuclear Regulatory Authority in Japan has said that Tokyo Electric should just admit that the water will need to be released into the ocean. The fishing cooperatives in the region are up in arms about that proposal, as are other governments like China, which are downstream with the currents. So the seafood supply off of Fukushima is very much at risk at this point. This is the next big crisis at Fukushima, including the fact that they are piling up the water behind these underground walls, softening the ground, and you have three destroyed reactors and a fourth building with a very precarious high-level radioactive waste storage pool, and there are warnings by seismologists and engineers that you are softening the ground and you could cause the collapse of those buildings.
Well, in fact, if the ground is soft, you get that effect that San Francisco had during the quake of 1918 or something, where it amplifies the motion above it.
And there's ongoing earthquakes at this site.
There was just a 5.6 one some weeks ago. Let's recapitulate the history of this, because, you know, when we first talked way back, what, almost 2 years ago now?
It's 2.5 years at this
point,
really.
2.5 years ago.
Yeah.
You were talking about, you and Paul were talking about how if the cores melt through the bottom of the steel containers and they start going into the ground, there's a lot of concrete under there, but if they get through that concrete and start heading toward groundwater, there were a couple of possible outcomes. One was the contamination of the groundwater. The other was that there could be so much heat colliding with enough water and it could produce a steam explosion. Is that what the China syndrome definition is, and what's going on right now relative to those scenarios?
Yeah, China syndrome is a description of a molten core entering groundwater. At that point, you've got such hot material that it causes steam explosions if there's no venting for that pressure to escape otherwise. So you'd have sort of like radioactive geysers erupting from the ground and releasing, you know, just unimaginable amounts of radioactivity. So the crazy thing about Fukushima is we don't really know the status of Unit 1, 2, and 3's core, or the reactor pressure vessels, or even the radiological containment structures. So if you were to listen to Tokyo Electric, whose credibility was nil before this catastrophe even began, actually, they would say that the containments are damaged, but they're largely intact, and most of the radioactivity is still inside. But what's to account for 100-fold increases in cesium, strontium, tritium in the groundwater in the bay off the coastline just in recent months? And just today, another press report, Asahi Shimbun, that in the last 5 days, there has been a 50-fold increase in radioactivity levels in certain of the groundwater samples. So something is changing, and questions start to need to be asked. What has given? You know, have one of these containment structures given way, allowing the flow of the radioactivity to increase dramatically? We just don't know.
Third option, that one of those, I mean, they've been pouring hundreds of millions of gallons of water on these things for the last 2 years to keep them cool, to keep them from melting down themselves. And they're storing much of that water, as you pointed out. Could it be that some of that water that has been stored is starting to itself contaminate groundwater?
There have been reports that this tank farm that's growing up the hillsides at Fukushima Daiichi, giant tanks of water, themselves have sprung leaks. They claim that the cooling water used on the cores, and that's 400 tons per day at those three melted down units, is largely being recycled. That's how the Wall Street Journal reported it today. But there's another 400 tons of water per day. That's the groundwater flooding the basements of these destroyed reactors, getting radioactively contaminated. That's what's getting pumped into that tank farm that's growing up the hillsides. So it's out of control. It's a hemorrhaging of radioactive water. And they're proposing all kinds of things, freezing the ground solid, creating walls, and even a cap of things like asphalt to try to contain this water.
Well, that's what they did with Chernobyl, wasn't it?
They did do some freezing with liquid nitrogen under Chernobyl to try to prevent the China syndrome of the core hitting the groundwater.
Concrete over it.
Yeah, so. Well, they've got the sarcophagus over Chernobyl, which is failing, and so they're building a second sarcophagus over the top of the first one. It's like a Russian doll that costs billions of dollars each time.
Right. So and Fukushima has not yet, you know, gotten to that point, but arguably is as bad a disaster as Chernobyl was. In fact, arguably worse.
Well, the myth in the mainstream media is it's the second worst nuclear catastrophe in human history. But both of these catastrophes, Chernobyl and Fukushima, are ongoing. And Chernobyl, the news has been very bad for months. In recent days, it's gotten worse. So. When comes the point when Fukushima surpasses Chernobyl?
And yet,
Chernobyl?
Meanwhile, we have two new nuclear power plants that are being built in Georgia, as I recall. This is
yeah,
crazy.
Vogtle 3 and 4, and the way they're getting away with that is they're gouging ratepayers, Georgia ratepayers, to pay for those things in advance. No electricity is being provided. These are unwilling shareholders who get none of the profits in the end.
Amazing. Kevin Camps, thanks for being with us tonight, Kevin.
Thank you, Tom.
Great to see you again.
You too.
We need to get subscribed and get this unity stronger and beat YouTube at their own game. Okay, that's what this is about. Like I say, go to the remix button, hit the remix button. That way you'll have this video and keep up with this. Otherwise, you know, YouTube's just going to control us, guys, and it's real.